Videos on the topic 3D printing seem to be a big thing on YouTube, so I made one. In the spirit of the channel, the main topic is surely, what does a 3D printer help you when you are working with old computers, VCRs or even cars? This video is aimed on 3D printing beginners. So if you are just thinking about if a 3D printer can be similarly helpful to you like an oscilloscope, then this is your video. Also, I will insert some links to other videos and you might be surprised that a 3D printer can even help you creating PCBs. In another video, I would also introduce the upgrades that I made to my 3D printer and how I rate them, but this is not the topic for this video. So if you already have some knowledge on the topic, then this is likely not your video. So in this case, I would like to say see you in the next video, either on the second 3D printer video or on a completely different topic. In this video, we are looking at the basics. Why most 3D printers are actually 2.5D printers, an overview of the four most common technologies from professional and consumer grade, a comparison of the two consumer technologies FDM and SLA, and what is more suitable for what, and finally, as we focus on FDM, an overview on the different FDM filaments. All this after the intro. Printing and retro technology, how does this connect? Why would you need a 3D printer if you want to do something with old computers? Other old technology, like for example VCRs? Or maybe you are working on your car? You might be surprised what a 3D printer could do for you when you are handling old technology. We are mainly dealing with computers, so the examples are from this field. Sites like Thingiverse and similar can definitely help you if you feed them with the proper search requests. For example, we are looking for a cooler clamp for a 486 CPU. Who doesn't know this? They either get lost or they break. And as you can see here, we have a regular 486 cooler clamp, and for the overclockers among us, a clamp to fix a Pentium cooler on a 486. Surely I have printed them both for demonstration. Also on Thingiverse, the mounting clamps for the front panel of my Li'an Li case, here right in the picture. The hard drive bracket for a Power Mac, a GoTek mount for the Amiga 500, or a cartridge case for the C64 can also be found on Thingiverse. And when DOS Reloaded user Scorp, better known for his YouTube channel Necroware, introduced his joystick to USB adapter, it didn't take long until DOS Reloaded user i44dbx introduced the matching case to it. All open source to print it yourself. And if you are doing your own project, just launch FreeCAD, Autodesk Fusion or similar, and do your own case, like I did with my RetroArdo input. In the beginning I said that a 3D printer is indeed a 2.5D printer, and this wasn't a joke. 3D printers build their print layer by layer. FDM printers have a strong similarity to CNC routers and use the same command set, the G-code. A CNC router that is working layer by layer and not moving all three axes at the same time is called 2.5D. This doesn't change anything on the fact that in the end you will get a three-dimensional object. FDM printers are capable to operate in a real 3D mode. This is called non-planar slicing, but can only be applied in limits due to the nozzle and the cooling duct being in the way. Now we are looking on the technologies. The most common one is the FDM printer. And this is very likely the result when a CNC router and a hot glue gun have a child together. In the 2D printer world, the most common relative is a pen plotter. The material is applied layer by layer, so 2.5D, or with limitations, also non-planar, in 3D. Overhangs on a certain amount require support structures. Using manual filament change on layer chain, dual extruders, color changers or tool changers, also multicolor printing is possible. The second common technology in the consumer world is SLA. This stands for stereolithograph. This name was chosen because it looks a little bit like the print platform is pushing down like on a lithograph stone. The process of curing the resin is photochemical, so it's also a little bit relative to a photofilm. Material is applied layer by layer, 2.5D. Overhangs require supports and no multicolored prints are possible. In the professional world, we also find 3D inkjet printers. The way that they move the print head reminds surely of the 2D inkjet printers. The material is applied layer by layer, 2.5D. And as also an inkjet cannot print into thin air, it applies a wax layer by layer to use as a support structure. The resins can be mixed in the print head, so multicolor prints up to two color are possible. Where you have an inkjet printer, you also have a laser printer. At least it's something with powder and laser, the remaining concept is different. The material is applied layer by layer, 2.5D. Selective laser sintering uses plastic powders like polyamide, known as nylon, and selective laser melting can even use metals, as the non-melted powder from the previous layer can act as a support. No support structures are required. Multicolor printing is not possible. Let's have a look on the differences between FDM and SLA printers. FDM operates with filaments made from different plastics, some of them also reinforced with glass or carbon fiber, while SLA only uses resin. And even a resin called like ABS has an ABS look but not the same material properties. Both material types are available in hard and flexible, in opaque or transparent. Both printer types exist in small and big. However, within the same price range, FDM printers are always superior to SLA printers in regards of build space. FDM prints always have this typical 3D printing look. Patterns of the printing part, visible layers, and problems with fine details. SLA prints are cleaner and show much more fine details. Basically, all 3D prints are only one color. However, manually or with additional hardware also automated, you can change colors during an FDM print. For SLA, this is not possible. SLA print time only depends on the height. For FDM, it also depends on board and width. With both printing technologies, you need to remove the support structures. FDM prints can be reworked by grinding them, or you can opt for chemical smoothing, like ABS, with acetone fumes. SLA prints need to be washed with isopropyl alcohol, then cured with UV light, and in some cases, they also might require a little bit of grinding. As FDM printers are very similar to CNC routers, there are some models with interchangeable tool heads. These can also do CNC milling or laser engraving. SLA printers do not have such a second life. At least not officially. Inofficially, you can use an SLA printer to expose your PCBs. These can afterwards then be developed and etched. FDM printers can only be used to make PCBs if they have the CNC milling functionality. The lifehack for FDM printers is that using TPU filament, you can print on t-shirts. If you want to build case parts that require brass thread inserts, your winning match is the FDM printer. Melting in these inserts is only possible with plastic. For resin, you can glue them in, but this is not as stable. In the hobby area, FDM is typically used where size and functionality matters. SLA is more the technology for fine details and fine mechanics. Looking at the materials, PLA is definitely the easy way to go. Except from abrasive additives, like low and dark particles, carbon or glass fiber, where a hardened, wear-resistant nozzle is highly recommended, there is nothing special that you need to keep in mind. ABS is extremely difficult to print as it tends to warp. Also, an all-metal hot end is highly recommended. The high printing temperatures required for ABS can disintegrate a PTFE of a Bowden tube, which can cause poisonous fumes. However, ABS is also the material our old computer cases are made of. And as ABS parts can be cold welded by using acetone, any ABS cold weld connection is much more stable than any glue connection you will ever make. The other materials in this table I won't cover in full detail. However, a special mentioning still goes to TPU. This is a very flexible material. It is relatively easy to print. However, its consistency is more like a boiled spaghetti, and so it does require a direct extruder. These flexible prints are perfect for modeling and noise decoupling. And if you require material that is highly chemical and weather resistant, for example for automotive parts, then polyamide, also called nylon, is your material. I hope you have learned something that you can use, and see you in the next video.